Thank you, Sophie, for your kind introduction. It's a real pleasure to be here, especially this is only young faces. But just come from the class, I presume. I think new classes. Let me just start by perhaps contextualizing this topic. You know, why biotech GM crops? I think let me just start by saying that in the last 20 years, this is probably one of the most important new technologies that have come along to help farmers grow more on less land, to help us conserve the environment much better by reducing the use of inputs, and actually more importantly, to make farming more attractive to farmers. Okay? In the process, hopefully more profitable to farmers. So that's really the context why our technology as a technology which is based on very modern science, especially science and molecular biology, has played such a vital role in modern agriculture. And it's very likely to continue. Because this is an academic audience, so I can take license a little bit here and deviate from my usual talking and so on. Yeah? I hope you have a good discussion, interaction. My real job really is I'm just a professor in Nanyang Technological University, where I wear many hats. Okay? That's my daytime job. You know, as Sunny Toronto knows, I usually introduce people by saying that my nighttime job, I do a lot of pro bono work for many, many organizations. Okay? Sit on many different committees. I think one of the committees I sit on, which is very relevant to biotech, is in Singapore. We have a genetic modification advisory committee, the GMAC, which is almost similar to your National Biosafety Committee in the Philippines. So I chair the committee to help evaluate all the applications by technology developers to release their crops in the environment. I mentioned this just to illustrate the fact that every country, every one of the 26 countries that grows GM crops has in place a regulatory system that is very strict, much stricter than any conventional variety that is released. Yeah? And that no GM or biotech crop is released in the environment until it satisfies all these committees, which are government committees. My purpose today anyway is to talk to you about biotech crops and what has happened in this last year, 2016. 2016 has been a very exciting year for biotechnology. And in the next few minutes, I'll give you some of the facts as to why. But my presentation will cover three aspects of biotech crops. The first is to talk about biotech crop adoption in 2016. The next is to give you an assessment of the impact of biotech crops over the last 21 years. It's been 21 years since the first biotech crop was commercialized. So what has been the impact in those last 21 years? Different assessments have been done, and let me share that with you. And then finally, perhaps gaze in the crystal ball a little bit. What are future prospects, especially for the younger folks? Okay? What are the future prospects in terms of this technology? You want to become a farmer, or if you want to become a researcher, or you want to become a fully underpaid academic? Okay? They are all potential prospects for the future in terms of biotechnology. So let's look at biotech crop production in 2016. Let me start off first by highlighting an important fact. There are many countries today growing the four major biotech crops: soybean, maize, corn, cotton, and canola, in which more than 90% of the country's planted area are already biotech crops, biotech varieties. So this first slide gives you details of that. For soybean, biotech soybean is present in those countries to the tune of greater than 90%. In USA, Brazil, Argentina, Canada, South Africa, and Uruguay. Biotech maize, in the US, Brazil, Argentina, Canada, South Africa, and Uruguay. You notice that in each of those, there's a good mix of developing and developed countries. Okay. Then biotech cotton. Countries have extensive plantings. In the USA, Argentina, India, China, Pakistan, South Africa, Mexico, Australia, and Myanmar. For a country like Australia, I was talking to some Australians just the other day, it says it's close to 100% biotech in Australia. It's 99.99% basically. all biotech problems now. And this really attests to the relevance of this technology to help farmers fight the problems of growing cotton. It's the insect pest, very critical, and then secondly, climate. Climate actually has a big factor on yield. Inevitably, I think they find that by growing GM cotton, they have some guarantee to reduce the effect of pests compounded with climate. The next is biotech canola, which is both USA and Canada, have plantings of more than 90% in those countries. So this is the big helicopter view of those countries that are almost predominantly biotech now in those crops. Now let's look at a bit more detail. I mentioned that 2016 was essentially a banner year. Sorry, 2016, the global area of biotech crops peaked at 185.1 million hectares. This is the highest planting of any year since commercial planting first started in 1996. That's the significance. And of these 185.1 million hectares, 99.6 million hectares are in developing countries. The curve in red. And 85.5 million hectares are in the developed industrialized countries in blue. So 2016 really shows the resumed high adoption of biotech crops. Recall we had a slight lull in 2015 because of the drop in commodity prices. At that time, ISAAA predicted that should commodity prices become more favorable, farmers will start planting again. And in retrospect, we were proven right on this score. In 2016, we saw indeed increased planting itself. But what is also interesting, for those of you who didn't attend last year's briefing, was that in 2015, we also made the point that in spite of reduced plantings worldwide of commodities because of prices, the percentage of biotech crops from each of those crops held steady and even increased in some countries. Again, this is a testament to the fact that farmers like this technology. In every country where farmers have been given the choice between these varieties and other varieties, they have chosen these varieties because the yield-enhancing benefits is given them. This morning, I shared an answer to a question that it's not just that these crops allow farmers to gain a yield advantage. There's also a social element, a social mental element, which is very critical. And I'll tell you a story here. As a professor, I like to embellish my lectures with stories. Okay? I was visiting India, this part of India, a major cotton growing area, in the beginning of the BT cotton revolution there. And one farmer told me, now that I'm planting BT cotton, I can go to sleep tonight peacefully, knowing that tomorrow morning when I wake up, I will still have my BT crop. Why did he say that? He said that because in that particular area of India, the pests, insect pests in that area, had developed so much resistance to the cocktail of insecticides that no insecticide was effective anymore. Basically, they couldn't grow a crop. You plant it today, this is almost gone tomorrow. It's like a locust attack. Okay? That level of severity. So this particular farmer just said that this is an element that most researchers don't evaluate. Okay, most economists don't even look at that aspect of it. It's a qualitative impact, which is very critical. Critical if you want people to continue farming. Okay, and critical if you want younger people to get into farming. That this peace of mind that their crop will indeed still be there and allow them to earn a livelihood from the crop. So that's what underpins on this data. Now, what this graph show too is that, you know, compared to 1996, which was the first full year of commercialization, there's been a 110-fold increase in the area of the biotech crops. When you accumulate every year the area, the cumulative area of biotech crops exceeds 2.1 billion hectares. There are very few new technologies that can claim this impact. Hybridcorn perhaps can claim, almost close to that, I think. Very few technologies can claim this particular impact. Now, what is also very important is that if you look at, say, rice example, I don't know if there's any more yearly year, IRA, even in its best years, I don't think we should be doing like this. Okay? So that's how synthetic technology is, in terms of impacting ecosystems and so on. Sorry, I said I'm a professor, right? So I want to just make sure you're paying attention. I'm going to ask you a quiz, slight question, see what's the answer. Who knows which were the two big countries in 1996 that commercialized biotech crops? Which are the two big countries in 1996? The USA, obviously, right? Which was the other country that did, then went backwards? And you're still regretting it. Any guess? No prizes, unfortunately. It was China. Yeah, China was a real pioneer in this. Yeah? But they reverted. You can ask me why they don't if you want to. Okay, let's continue. I think I got your attention there. Okay. Now let's look at this map here. I mentioned that 2016 saw an increase. In percentage terms, there was a 3% increase in the area in 2016 relative to 2015. And 3% translates into roughly 5.4 million hectares worldwide. Okay. But that's a very broad figure, 3%, covering the whole global area. Underneath the 3% are actually very interesting statistics. If you go into the ISAAA website and download the executive summary and ISAAA brief, it's free, right? Free of charge, and read the data in there, you will get some very interesting data. Amongst which is the fact that in 2016, some countries actually had double-digit increases in the area of biotech crops. Australia had a 29% increase in its biotech area. South Africa, 17%. Brazil, 11%. So eight figures like that. And in Brazil, 11% was translated for the down in November maize. 22% increase in maize, biotech maize, in Brazil. Okay. In Australia, I think it was a 90% increase in cotton. South Africa, 22% increase in the maize. And again, this morning I shared that in South Africa, which is the maize-eating country, the country that uses maize or corn for animal feed, most of the 20% increase, in fact, was from hot corn. The corn, who's from the Visayas here? Anybody? It's like the corn you eat in the Visayas, or white corn. Yeah? Yeah. So this is just to show you the fact that in South Africa, they actually eat corn, okay? And large area, 50% of the area, was biotech corn. And it's white corn. Yeah? So it's not just safe for animals, it's safe for human consumption as well. Okay? Which is how the stories you always hear when you start googling whether it's safe or not. Yeah? Now if you look overall at the macro level, the top five countries shown on the other side, top five countries there, basically planted 91% of all the biotech crops. Now these top five countries, three of them in the developing world, namely Brazil, Argentina, and India, and two from the industrial world, namely the USA and Canada. So this, I hope, gives you a picture of the global map. But the other interesting story about this map is that this part of the world, which is almost all green, green biotech crops, compared to this part of the world, and this part of the world, which is only marginally green here, and not too bad here, growing in terms of percentage green, this part of the world has been the most consistent producer and supplier of corn and soybean to the rest of the world. Okay? Very, very much technology-enabled farming in this part of the world. With the net result that you can produce a lot more yield per unit area. In another slide, I'll give you a bit more detail on this. Yeah? But this is important because moving forward towards the future, as populations grow, again another quiz. What is the expected world population by 2050? Come on, y'all, UPLB, the Center of Agriculture Research in the Philippines. It could reach 10 billion. It could. We don't know. Okay? Those are the estimates. Yeah? The 10 billion will come sooner than that. Again, a lot depends really on all the stuff the governments are doing. So this shows you that distribution. Let's move on. If you're interested in figures, 185.1 million hectares divided amongst 26 countries, of which 19 are developing countries and 7 industrial countries. And several years ago, the developing countries overtook the developed countries. And this is crop area, biotech crop area. Okay. This is another significant fact, because we believe that going forward, most of the growth in biotech crop areas will come from the developing countries, including the Philippines. And the reason is that, for those of you who are very sharp and have good memory, remember the earlier slide I showed, the first slide I showed, and 90% of crop area under biotech, you notice that many of those countries don't have any more upsides to go. Okay? In other words, they've just exceeded the limit to which more can be planted in a particular area. If you're in Australia and you're growing cotton, you're already 99.9%, how much more can you grow? You can't go beyond 100%, obviously, right? In the Philippines is only growing about 65%, right? 65% of GM corn, which means another 35% potentially, the underlying potentially, because not all corn areas are suitable, you know, for modern corn in the Philippines, same as other parts of the world. But there's a huge upside for that, for this kind of crops in certain parts of the world. Moving on, I want to show this. I want to amplify it again with the previous map. This basically gives you a bit more data on the planting for themselves. Which country, which region, and so on. Again, I think it reinforces the point that the Western Hemisphere has really been very quick in adopting this technology. And the net result is that the productivity of all the major crops is very high, you know, compared to the Asian countries. And it's actually very sad. You know, we were in China earlier this month to talk about, you know, biotech crops. Yeah? You know, China is the center of origin of soybean. Okay? And yet China imports at least 50 million tons of soybean every year. Okay? Now to me, you know, as an ethnic Chinese, yeah, I'm not from China, but somebody with Chinese origin, I can't feel very sad for China that is so dependent on another region of the world for a crop where the center of origin is China itself. So the question is, we ask, why aren't the Chinese doing more to increase the production and productivity of crop soybean? And they've got all these genetic resources because they're center of origin. It's an interesting question, especially a question that should be asked at the final exams. Now, to give a bit more detail on this breakdown, if you look at North America, in North America, basically Canada and the USA, North America is still the region with the largest area of biotech crops, 84.5 million hectares. And it's not just the big four anymore. Remember the big four, maize, soybean, cotton, canola? There's also biotech sugar beet, alfalfa, papaya, squash, and potato. That's there, in North America. The second largest area, 80 million hectares, is Latin America. They're basically, those countries there, 10 countries roughly, Brazil, Argentina, and so on and so forth. Yeah? And here, the big three, plus pineapple, which is going to Latin America. Asia and the Pacific, we're still mainly cotton, in the big countries of India, China, and Australia, basically. Yeah? Maize, Philippines can be proud. First country, yeah? Especially in the ASEAN region, you know, they actually grow maize. So, canola, eggplant. Some of us were hoping 5 years ago that the Philippines would be the first country to grow the eggplant. We were all quite disappointed. And Bangladesh became the first country. And the Bangladesh story is a very interesting story, which you're interested in, we'll talk about it in the Q&A time. Because in Bangladesh, you know, the fact that farmers don't eat the eggplant themselves when they grow. Because they spray up to 70 sprays per crop. And if you were a farmer, would you eat that crop if you spread 70 applications? The farmers that I've interviewed, many farmers actually say that we grow a separate crop. We don't mind eating the tallow with the holes in it. Because we know that the pesticide load is minimal in those eggplants. Those are very clean, no holes, they go to the middle of the cities. Not like us. No, we live in cities. Yeah? So, a very courageous minister in Bangladesh, a lady for the matter, finally made a strong political decision. So, look, we can't continue poisoning our country persons, country men, country persons. Yeah? Let's introduce BT eggplant. And today, I believe, I have to trust Ola because she's younger than me, lots of good memory. 8,000 hectares? BT eggplant? 700, sorry, I was wrong. 700 hectares in Bangladesh, BT eggplant. With BT eggplant or the eggplant, you don't need large areas to grow a lot of eggplant, obviously. Yeah? So you really can't compare apples and oranges and so forth. Okay, moving on. European Union. And again, this is quite contrary to popular belief. The EU has four countries that actually grow GM crops. So as students, the next time one of your colleagues says that EU doesn't grow GM crops, tell them they're wrong. Please, right? There are at least four countries, hopefully there'll be more in the future, give 136,000 hectares of maize, basically. And last year, 2016, there was an increase of 13% over 2015 of maize grown in the EU. Now the EU, incidentally, is also one of the biggest importing regions of GM produce. From the Americas especially. If they didn't import GM produce, they couldn't sustain the animal industry at all in the EU. Just like many of us in Asia. If we don't import from the West, we can't continue eating the chicken, the fish, and pork, basically. Because those are very dependent on the soybean and corn meal that is imported from the West. Then Africa, 2.8 million hectares. Particularly in South Africa and Sudan. Maize, soybean, and cotton. Cotton mainly in Sudan and South Africa. But we're very optimistic about Africa because the signs are there. At least 10 African countries are now moving forward, okay, in terms of testing, open trials, and hopefully from after that, into commercialization. So those are actually very promising signs of what's happening in Africa. Indeed. Now, if you look at the four big crops, these are the big ones of soybean, cotton, maize, and canola. Soybean probably has the highest adoption. Globally, 78% of global soybean are now biotech soybean. And for all the reasons that I've talked about, helping farmers grow more, you know, less drudgery, and so on. Yeah? Also conserving the soil. Cotton, 64%. Maize is only 26%, which means that if you look at these figures, you can say, hey, this has the most potential to grow in area. Yeah? And maize is still a very important crop. And again, speak about China. China actually has the world's largest rice and maize area. And yet China imports a lot of maize every year. Because of technology, basically. They use it quite a lot there. And canola, 24%. Bear this in mind as we go deeper into this topic, explain why this technology has become so important for us to help increase productivity. Okay? Bear in mind the potential here for maize, 26%, and in fact the soybean is only 78%. Move on then. Of course, for those of you who study biotechnology, all the crops come with certain traits, certain properties. Yeah? And these properties, if you look at conventional crops, every variety has an advantage of some kind, whether it's insect resistance or something else. Yeah? So in the case of biotech crops, the major trait, I'm sorry, this is, I jumped ahead a little bit. This is the one that shows traits. Okay? Major trait is herbicide tolerance, followed by stat traits, which is more than one trait, and then insect resistance. Commonly the stat traits are herbicide tolerance, insecticide resistance. sorry, insect resistance put together very commonly. I'm going to the previous slide. This is just to show you in graphical form the increased area of the four big crops. The soybean, corn, cotton, and canola. Really no rocket science here. It's just a nice growth curve, basically. In those, yeah? Starting from almost zero base here. The soybean probably reflects the importance of soybean to provide animal feed around the world. So those are the traits. Let me just pause for a second here. Any questions on this? I do this with an academic audience. Any questions? Anything that needs clarified before we go to the Q&A? Now, globally, maize increased last year as well, globally. There was a slight drop in cotton because of prices, oversupply, stocks of cotton. And cotton is basically a marketable commodity. So farmers are very, very responsive easily to pricing and the supply situations. Okay, now we'll move on then. Okay. The next part I was going to cover was the impact itself. And here I must give credit. I'll give a helicopter view of the overall impact of having biotech crops in the environment, growing biotech crops. The first impact area that we can mention is the area of crop production or productivity, which also results in income for farmers. Obviously, farmers grow a crop. This is because they love growing a crop. Usually, they grow a crop because they want to get a yield, which they can then sell with the right income. Right? Now, groups in Basel, two economists, have been doing these studies of impact for many years now, and they publish this every year. So ISAAA works closely with them, and we use their data in our brief, because they're the most authoritative data. Just like the ISAAA brief is the most authoritative source of the global area. So what these authors have found is that in the last 21 years, the farm income gains have been in the region of about 7.8 billion US dollars accruing to farmers themselves. So the farmers in total who have used biotech in their fields have cumulatively benefited to this tune, this income generated from biotech crops. And what is also most interesting is that if we dig deeper into the literature, quite a few studies have tried to look at the differential benefits of biotech crops. You know, those are really in economics. There's a lot of studies done on differential impact of technologies. Do they benefit bigger farmers, smaller farmers themselves? Okay. Is there a matter of scale involved? One of the early studies that was done on BT cotton was in fact by an alumnus of UPLB, Professor Ji Kun Huang in China. He's one of the most famous alumni of UPLB. He's now the director of the Chinese Center for Agricultural Policy. One of the early studies he did in 2002, he surveyed and studied a lot of BT cotton growers in China, in Hebei province. And his data shows very conclusively that the smaller the farmer, the bigger the proportion of benefit, just the income, to the farmer. That was the first instance of convincing benefit. Now, the other thing that he found, which was very useful, was that farmers who use BT cotton suffered less from ailments associated with insecticide poisoning, from spray drift. In fact, they analyzed blood samples and all that stuff. You know, and it showed that those who planted BT cotton had less exposure to insecticides because of the reduced spray on insecticides. Yeah. And therefore, they had to go to hospitals much less frequently than the farmers who didn't use BT cotton. And that's all published peer reviewed literature. Like I said, that's one of the most authoritative papers, early papers published. His last name is spelled H-U-A-N-G, Huang. Okay? And UPLB can be proud to produce something like that. Okay, so that's in terms of the productivity itself. Now the second is the contribution of biodiversity. You know, this is something that most people intuitively don't think about. Now, remember what I said earlier about producing more with less land. Today, we see the phenomenon of declining arable land. Land for farming is declining. Because very often land for farming is very nice flat land. It's also preferred for industrial estates, for housing estates, right? For many other users. In almost every Asian country, with the exception of the agrarian countries, Cambodia, Myanmar, land for farming has been declining. 5 to 10% a year, depending on the country itself. So what does this mean? It means that to produce the same amount of food, we either increase the yield per unit area, or what else? Or more land, right? More new land. Where do you get your new land from? Cut down forests. It's easier source. That's what we did 50 years ago, 60 years ago, when there was still plenty of forests to cut down. And today, deforestation is still an issue in many parts of Asia. But because of all the concern about biodiversity, climate change, the rate of deforestation is gone down, fortunately. Because we can't continue cutting down the forest, yeah? Without affecting the bigger environment. How does biotechnology play a role? It plays a role because by being able to grow more food in the same area of land, you avoid the need to cut more forests and you need more new land, right? And groups in Baffert have estimated that to this 21-year period, the productivity gain for biotech crops have actually meant that 174 million more hectares, virtual hectares, have been planted. We didn't have to cut down forests to produce another 174 million hectares. In the process, conserving biodiversity. Again, as we all know, biodiversity has many, many different facets. It's not just number of tree species. It's entire ecosystems that live within the ecosystems. Yeah? Very important indeed. The other way that biodiversity conservation has been done is also from the plowing. This also benefits the global warming. The biotech crops, especially the herbicide tolerant biotech crops, farmers can do conservation tillage. In North America in particular, they do what is called no-till. Okay? You don't even have to plow in the land. You just directly drill your seed in the land and then you spray. Kill the herbicides, under the weeds, sorry, kill the weeds. Okay? I don't know how many of you come from farm families. What is the main reason for plowing? It's not just to kill the land, plowing. It's also for weed control. Plowing is one of the main means of weed control, control weeds. So if you can control weeds without plowing the land, it's a big saving in labor. Okay? A big savings in the petroleum needed to power the machines that used to plow the land. It really goes to another benefit we talk about. Please read that. The next major impact of biotechnology crops in the environment is this one here, by reducing the insecticide load into the environment, especially through the BT crops. Incidentally, you know, with all the controversy about BT crops, you would think that we're doing something very new, okay, just using BT. And too often we forget the fact that BT versus Syngenta is actually the preferred insecticide for organic farmers. Okay. So all that science has done is to transfer the ability of this bacterium to produce an endotoxin into the corn plant. Okay. That's what science has done. So tapping on a very old practice of organic farmers using BT straws to control the diamondback moth. New science has allowed us now to use biotechnology to empower the plant with this ability. You know, those of you who have tried to spray for corn borers, you realize that it's so difficult to get your corn borers with insecticide spray. Because a large part of what you spray is lost. It doesn't hit the pest itself. Whereas with the BT technology, you are directly impacting the pests, especially the larvae within the corn stand. So, yeah? So a big reduction estimated 19% of the loading reduction itself, which is very important indeed. See, the side benefits of this kind of reduction is that it allows beneficial arthropods to blossom. It allows the spiders, all the other beneficial insects, to again come back to the fields. In fact, in North America, there's very good evidence to show that because of the GM corn and soybean, they now can go back to duck hunting in some of these fields, because the ducks are coming back to eat insects in those fields, which is an indirect benefit of this kind of technology. Now, the fourth major impact that this technology has had is on reducing CO2 emissions. And this has been done in several ways, including reduced use of petroleum, gasoline, for powering machinery to plow fields. The other is the conservation tillage. And these workers have estimated that 2015, about 26.7 billion kilos of CO2 was saved because of this technology. And that's equivalent to removing 12 million cars off the road. I think those of us who occasionally go into Manila, peak traffic, will realize the benefits of clean air by removing cars off the road. I came in last night, arrived at the airport about 11:30, and drove from the airport to Alabama. And I forgot what time of the day it was, because there were no cars around. I thought, what a pleasure, it only was like this every day. It's wonderful. And I also remember, you know, first coming to the Philippines. Sorry, I'm a professor, I'll tell a story. I first came to the Philippines in April 1, 1987. And traveled from Naye to Iri housing. It took us 35 minutes. Incredible. Today you're lucky if you're doing 40 minutes or 1 hour from the airport to here. It's increasingly gotten worse. Yeah? So anything that we can do to reduce the emissions from cars, and also in the process help us take care of the traffic, I think will be very beneficial to society as a whole, even in terms of mental health. Very useful. Okay, the next big impact. And this is the one that really strikes home at farmers. And it's the fact that 18 million small farmers, is our estimate, have benefited from this technology. And many of them are small farmers. We know that worldwide, there are about 500 million small farmers worldwide. So 18 million is still a fraction of the number of farmers who can benefit from this technology. So in terms of actual impact, I think we have to admit, but only with a very small impact on a small proportion of farmers. Many more can still benefit from this technology from a bigger range of crops. But with the 18 million, if you bring the families together, there's about 65 million people who have benefited from this technology over the last few years. And in this case, the estimate is 2016. So if you count at 21 years, there's been a lot of beneficiaries.
Right. Just moving on, I needed to show you this slide because this goes back to the earlier map I showed as to the benefits and the impact of having biotech crops. This map of the world comes from a report that was released on the 22nd of February this year. Okay. It's called, the report is called The Future of Food and Agriculture. It was a report put together by a big team of people working on behalf of the Food and Agriculture Organization, FAO-UN. Okay? There were many, many things said in the report. But to me, this map is very critical because it shows you the countries, generally, that are the food surplus countries. Countries that have the current potential and the future potential to export food because they're growing more than enough food for their own consumption. Okay? And these colors here, the ones here, and partly here as well, are the countries that are food deficit. In other words, you can produce a lot of food, but you still don't have enough. Except import. Okay? Now, this is important because these countries, as you saw in the previous map, are the ones that dominantly are very technology embracing. Okay? Technology enabled farming is very, very commonly practiced there, especially the BT technology.
just one many technologies. Huh? Now, if you want to drill down a bit deeper, why? Okay. What accounts for the yield difference? This net fact just shows that. You know, when I was at Erie many years ago, we spent a lot of time studying yield gaps. Because yield gaps, as we all know, are what is responsible for the difference between the potential yield of a variety and what farmers get. Okay? Even in the Philippines, some of your potential yield of rice is very high. Farmers get less than 3 to 5 tons per hectare. Basically, half of the potential is recovered. Okay? Look at this one here. US exporter, Canada exporter, Argentina exporter. Okay, these are high here. These are the major exporters. Yeah? 8, 9, 10 tons per hectare of corn. China, major importer. 6 is actually very high. Many of the farmers get much lower than this. And this biotech varieties, no biotech varieties yet. Which is why the strong interest by the Chinese government in BD corn. We were told that 2 years ago, the president of China made a promise. He made a promise that in 2 years' time, China is going to grow GM corn. Ola and I were in China for a meeting just earlier this month. And that's what they continued telling us. We said, we'll believe it when we see it. Because things don't move very fast in China at all. Yeah. But if China were to go biotech, then we can almost guarantee that their yield levels will increase dramatically. And they will need to import less corn. Okay? Which is very good for all the other countries to import corn. Because right now, we're all competing with China to import material from the West. But what is even more interesting in this slide here, and these figures here, taken from a book, a very authoritative meta-analysis book, done by Tony Fisher, Greg Edmonds, and Derek Biotin, 2013. You can Google that. Okay? They documented a lot of studies on yield in different countries. If you look at corn, and this is yield on farmers' fields, not experimental fields. Huh? They have shown that in Chile, under rainfall conditions, some farmers have achieved 22 tons per hectare, one crop. Okay. In the Philippines, what is the highest yield ever achieved by a corn grower? 10 tons? I think that's very rare. Okay. So you can imagine, if there are farmers that can grow this level of corn, you know, there's no issue of food security. More farmers can do this kind of farming. Same with soybean, 10 tons per hectare in Missouri, wheat, 15 tons, rice, 18 tons. And that's high. I know many years ago when I mentioned what you mean, 14 ton rice is actually quite common in several countries. In China, in parts of China, they routinely get 14 tons from one season of rice. You go to the country of Vietnam, they get 14 tons, two crops, 2.5 crops, maybe. So this really goes to show you how technology, the proper management, can really help us meet the challenges going forward. And biotech or yield is one of those enabling technologies, very key. And we've barely scratched the surface in terms of applications of molecular biology and biotechnology. There are a lot of other applications that we can only dream about now. And I just come on board. You know? I said to tell stories. Just this last Wednesday, I could meet a brainstorming meeting in Singapore. There's a lot of very high-powered people, including the industry, you know, who were asking the same questions, the new technologies, the new biotechnologies, what's that going to mean to us? Okay? And really, you know, it stretches your imagination, you know, in terms of the kind of applications that are coming on board, not just for plants, for animals, for human beings as well, all the new technologies, which I've really mentioned in a few minutes. Let's move on. So to put some pictures to it, here are the kind of crops, you know, there are some of the new offerings. Remember I mentioned that beyond the big four, there's a lot more diversity now. Papaya is actually not an old new story, it's an old story. Starting first in Hawaii, right? Solo papaya, where, you know, those who are young enough and haven't been married yet, for a honeymoon in Hawaii, on the beach there, this is what you'll be eating. Because every hotel there serves this. And because GM papaya is the only papaya that can be grown in Hawaii because of the virus problem. You can't grow that kind of papaya. Squash, eggplant, sugar beet, and potato. And this is the
exciting thing that's come on board just this last year, non-browning potato. I think those of you who cook, you know, that you cut potato, after a while it turns brown, right? And people might not like it, just throw it away, because it's turned brown. Even though the nutrition value is not effective, the cosmetically it's terrible. It's just like pears, apples, right? Cut it, leave it outside, and after a while it all turns brown. Nobody likes to eat it, because it doesn't look good. Yeah? So imagine that you have a technology which prevents this, up to a certain time, prolongs the freshness look of this, yeah? But on a serious note, this will help reduce wastage and loss. Okay? And waste and food loss is a major issue in today's consuming society. Okay? It's not just in the big cities, almost everywhere. You know, the next time you go to a restaurant, look at how much food is wasted. How much people don't finish, how much is thrown away. It actually gets worse as countries get richer, as societies get richer. Up to half the meal be thrown away because of food waste. Huh? So these are examples. Here's a bit more data, sort of more recent approvals in terms of traits. Even alfalfa with apples, then non-browning apples, Arctic series of apples. They're not available in the Philippines yet. Maybe the next few years will be here. But before it comes here, obviously, it's going to go through regulatory approval. Right? We import it. Okay. And this is the other area. It's actually, right now, we've seen a lot of attention. Because Asia, we don't have this technology yet. And many of our regulators are now asking questions, what do we do about this technology? This morning at the media conference, there are a lot of interesting questions to the regulator about this. How to be proactive, you know, to have a reference system in place to receive this exciting new product coming in. Asia, pineapple, soybean, bean, a couple more data here. But with the potatoes, the approvals in 2016 include this series of potatoes called the Enid series. This is now the generation 2. And generation 2 actually has step traits. Remember the previous graph I showed you on soybean, corn and others? Yeah, where the step traits are herbicide tolerance and insecticide resistance. Now these are now multiple traits, basically. So you look at it as a step. Variety here. There's browning, non-bruising. There's acrylamide. Now the acrylamide, again, is an interesting story. Every time you fry potatoes under high temperature, potatoes contain asparagine. The asparagine gets converted into acrylamide, which is potentially cancer causing. So if you can reduce acrylamide, you might reduce the prevalence of cancer. You might, because they cause so many problems. It's shown yet. Huh? It's a matter of time. Low reduced sugars, plus a problem that has been affecting all of us who are interested in potatoes, potato leg cut. This is one of the most serious diseases of potato, even in lowland conditions. Potato leg cut, potato early cut. These two diseases are big problems which constrain potato production. Okay? China, we know, wants to increase its area of potatoes. To do that, they will have to tackle the leg cut problems, so these are the issues. So this series of potatoes offer great potential to expand potato area. Now why is that important? This is not to say that everybody is going to grow potato either. But everybody might reduce their consumption of rice. Yeah? And going forward, because 1 kilo of rice needs 5,000 kilos of water to produce, okay? You're going to have less water going forward in the future with climate change. So a lot of researchers and governments are actually looking at water-efficient crops to grow in anticipation of climate change. And part of the strategy for climate-smart agriculture is we need to find varieties that can help us meet these challenges. Less water, erratic water, too much water, flooding, and also saltiness, saltwater intrusion itself, especially in the rice-growing areas. So all this really exciting stuff is coming along with the new biotechnologies. So I'll just move on. Okay, so far I've emphasized commercialization and growing. Okay. We mustn't forget that, you know, many other countries beyond the 26 that don't grow import a lot of GM products. Okay. Okay, if you look at the world on balance, almost every country imports food. Even the USA, which is considered the most secure country in the world, they import on purpose. Because no country can produce all that its consumers want. Okay? So there will always be trade, okay? An exchange of produce between countries. In the case of biotech crops, 40 countries issued a approvals for 3,768 sort of events of GM crops, including the EU. The EU imports a lot of products for GM. And this is just to help debunk. So you may think that GM doesn't eat any percent, that the EU doesn't eat any GM food. It's not true at all. GM should import all GM food. Now this last year too, 2016 has been important, because some organizations like FAO have come out of the closet and declared a strong support for biotechnology. FAO used to sit on the fence, because FAO is the Global Ministry of Agriculture. It's got members who like biotech, members who are not too sure about tech, members who say that they want biotech. Okay? So as a global ministry, they have to walk a fine line. Politics, basically. Okay? But this last year, 2016, they had a global conference on agricultural biotechnology in Rome. Very strong statement saying that biotechnology is important technology going forward with regard to 50% increase in demand for food by 2050. Very strong statement. And they are now acting on a global conference by holding a regional conference here in Asia in the second half of this year. Again, to build up support and understanding of agricultural biotechnology. So there is a global momentum growing towards acceptance of biotechnology in this respect. Yeah? And as ISAAA, we continue to monitor this, okay, to see what country is doing what and to provide the evidence. If you want to learn more, go to our website, okay, because we have a global knowledge center that populates this website and keeps it current almost every week. Yeah. So future prospects. I think that the three broad areas which we can see happening. One is the expansion of global GM area, the current crops. Remember the crop that I said has the most upside? Maize. Right? Maize has a lot of upside. Then new crops coming along, the pipeline, they have not been grown before. Then the new breeding techniques offer just tremendous opportunities for new products which may not even be food. Right? And this is something really worth watching. Especially for those of you who are studying microbiology and so on. Now, of course, regulation. Remember I mentioned earlier that regulation is a very key enabler. It's science-based regulation. But this morning we also heard that apart from regulations in place, we must have ways to implement the regulation in a way that is not hurdle different steps. So having regulation is one thing, but being able to implement the regulation is another. So many countries have nice regulatory systems, but don't have the capacity to implement those. And that's led to issues. Issues, for example, you know, in the asynchronous approvals across countries. So some countries cannot import because they haven't approved yet. Certain products can be imported and so on. Lots of issues there. Yeah? Now in terms of actual expansion itself, you know, from what we can assess, maize field still offers the most potential. Okay? Total of 100 million hectares worldwide, of which 60 million are in Asia, China alone. As I mentioned earlier, China is the world's biggest in terms of land area of maize. In Africa, smaller parcels. Cotton, there's a lot of potential in Africa in particular. The potato. Potato offers great potential, especially in China, where the government itself has expressed a desire to grow more potatoes. Potatoes are actually quite interesting in China. They're treated both as a staple, not as a vegetable. Okay? So part of the drive to grow more, eating more vegetables. So this is just some pictorial views of some of these new products. Pigeon peas, chickpeas, sugarcane, tapioca, banana, apple, golden rice, wheat, so on. Right? And just hot off the press, just to show the momentum this week. India has the Ministry of Environment, Forestry and Climate Change through their GAC. The GAC is the Genetic Engineering Advisory Committee. It's finally approved GM mustard, genetically modified mustard, which was developed by the public sector university, Delhi University. This is really very hot news indeed. Huh? We're hoping that there won't be further hurdles to farmers benefiting from having this technology. I just want to say a few words about the new breeding technologies, because these are coming on board in many countries. It's an extension of old breeding technologies. Because breeding innovations are coming so fast that, you know, today,
it's actually very difficult with some of these modern techniques to tell the difference between conventional breeding and some of these new techniques. Because they don't involve transgenic transfers at all. And that's where regulators have a hard time figuring out what to do. But they're very powerful indeed. Just introducing new traits to farmers. I think I'm going to finish off there by just showing this book, which I would urge you to download. This is the FAO report which I referred to. Very, very enlightening in terms of what they're projecting. And in this particular publication, they list 15 trends which are going to affect us going forward. Okay? These trends will affect the increase in demand for food by 2015. The 50% increase in demand for food. And the traits that I've marked in red are the traits that lend themselves to biotechnology playing a role. Biotechnology crops playing a role. Okay? So to finish off, perhaps re-emphasize the point that biotechnology crops, we feel, are a very important contribution to agriculture. The us meeting the needs of more food, more feed, more fiber, and also more fuel. We want it that way. So going forward, still a lot of work to be done indeed. And for those of you who don't want to read this big report, okay, you can download a couple of critiques that I did just this last month. See, a lot of people don't know the report. They have to read summaries or op-eds. Yeah? So I've written some commentaries based on these reports. One is really the first, you know, how should we in Asia respond to production challenges? Because that was a big part of the FAO report. And they give you different challenges in there and different responses. So we actually wrote out and said, what do we think will work in Asia? Yeah? The second is this question of policy. Therefore, for governments to adequately address issues, balancing consumers on low prices, farmers on high prices, you've got to recalibrate your policies to maintain a balance between those two. Right? You can't give farmers high prices for their crops, okay, and consumers low prices at the same time. There's a supply chain element that links those two. You raise one, you raise the other. So what do you do about it? Okay? Some things can be done, so recalibrating your policies of support and so on. For farmers. So download this, is all free from this website. This is the other thing I do, as I think Sophie is introducing. I'm also a senior fellow here in this organization in a center called the Center for Non-Traditional Security Studies. Okay? Traditional security is all military security. That's what your president talks a lot about, South China Seas, and so on and so forth. That's traditional military security. Many countries now look at non-traditional security. Food is one of them. Food security. Food can be a new weapon. Okay? To threaten security. So our center deals with food as a security issue, water as a security issue, energy as a security issue, and next is labor. I haven't mentioned here in this audience here, but the fact that farmers are all getting old all over the world. Few young people want to go into farming. So the farming population there is declining. Okay? That can be a security issue for large farming countries. So what do you do about it? Okay? Technology is one of the solutions to get more young people into farming. Okay? I should really ask these younger folks, say, what would get you to become farmers? Don't have to work in the sun, for one. That's the answer I get a lot in Singapore. You don't want to work in the sun. They want a high-tech aircon room for farming. And interesting enough, that's happening in Singapore. Eventually, I can tell you a story about that. Okay? There are actually a lot of young startups in Singapore that are growing vegetables indoors with ICT, Internet of Things, okay? Artificial lighting. And they're producing biomass trays that are 10 times what they grow outside. Okay? And the consumers are buying it at a premium. Okay? So imagination can really stretch, yeah? In terms of applying new technologies to grow more food to help us. So with that, I think I've taken up more than that time than I should. I'm sorry, apologies for that. But professors have a habit of continuing, unfortunately. They're not stopped. I hope I didn't get somebody to miss your lecture. The next lecture. So thank you very much for listening.